Hello and welcome to the Penguin Prof channel. Joining me today in the Penguin Prof Zoom room is Jason Baer. He is a joint doctoral student at San Diego State University and the University of California at San Diego in cell and molecular biology. And he wrote an amazing article last month called COVID-19, The Road to a New Normal. And I was taken by that so much. I reached out and he said he would be willing to do an interview, answer questions from you guys, and he's here with us today. So thank you so much, Jason, for joining me. This is really cool.
Absolutely. Thank you, Valerie. I'm really excited to be here. I'm a big fan of your work at the Penguin Prof.
Oh, thank you so much. Can you tell us actually what lab you are working in and who you're working with at the moment?
Absolutely. So I'm working at San Diego State University, and I work in Forrest Rower's lab. And historically, we've done a lot of work on environmental virology. We focus on virology and microbiology in a lot of different environments, such as the human lung in cystic fibrosis patients, such as all the way to coral reefs. All of us, with the tools that we have in the lab and the knowledge we have about environmental virology, decided to turn towards a project that could broadly benefit this COVID-19 response. One interesting thing with viruses is that the ways they can be transmitted, we call them reservoirs. And so one thing we understand really well is that humans can be a very potent reservoir for viral transmission, which basically just means that we see a lot of person-to-person contact. And so this is one reservoir of transmission that we're pretty familiar with, especially in the case of SARS-CoV-2, the virus that causes COVID-19. Now, one thing we don't understand as well is if there are other reservoirs, such as the environment, that can be effective at transmitting this virus. And this is going to be really, really important knowledge as we move into this and as we stay in this quarantine phase for longer periods of time. One thing we are doing to try and understand that is we're sampling broadly surfaces all around San Diego. And then also we are opening this up as kind of a citizen science project where we're providing sampling kits for people to be able to test. And so they can sample surfaces and then they can send us the samples. We run them on RT-PCR, the standard testing protocol for SARS-CoV-2. And what we're trying to do is trying to determine if these things can last for a significant amount of time and where we see them. So can viral particles that get shed from people that are infected with the virus end up on these surfaces, and can they stick around long enough for us to be able to detect them? What these sampling kits are going to allow us to do is get a better sense of where this virus is distributed, how prevalent it is in the urban environment, and will hopefully ultimately give us a better idea of how to handle this whole situation.
What Jason was talking about regarding the sampling kits, we thought it would be really fun to show you how those work. This right now is a small pilot project in San Diego, but hopefully it will be expanded. So Jason, take it away. Show us how they work.
So this is an exciting set of kits that we've developed. We just have a few so far, but this is one of the ways that we've been collecting data from the environment so far regarding the SARS-CoV-2 virus. So one of the important parts of this is to keep yourself safe while we sample. And so in every one of these kits, there are 20 pairs of gloves, and there are 20 samples in each of these kits. And I'm going to show you guys now generally how we've developed the sampling procedure so that we can collect these samples. And then we have these tubes called that are filled with a very small amount of this pink liquid, which is called triazole. And triazole is excellent at deactivating and at preserving the genetic material of the virus. And so one really, really important thing that we need to preserve is the RNA, or its genetic material is similar to DNA, so that we can actually detect this thing later on. And so to preserve that, we have this tube. And then one of the things we do is we take a small piece of polyester, and we use polyester because it's actually better at sorbing viral particles than something like cotton would be, for example. We have some studies that have shown that. We take our little swab of polyester for a sample. We dip it into this. It's called 0.5 SDS, but really SDS is the main active ingredient in dish soap. And so really this is just a pure form of dish soap, which is just good for helping it get off of the surface. So we take our swab, we dip it in the SDS, and then we gently swab the surface of interest. Now, once again, as mentioned before, this can be ATMs, this can be door handles, dry erase markers, gyms, all these kinds of places that we expect people to touch frequently and where they could shed active viral particles. We take our toothpick and our tube of triazole. Now, triazole is pretty nasty stuff. it's a pretty gnarly, chemical. And so one of the things we do is we put these SDSs in our kit, which are just explain all the different hazards with it. And then this is one of the reasons why we use gloves as well. So we're careful. We use proper scientific technique. We push this sample into the triazole until it's submerged, which will hopefully preserve all of the genetic material for the viruses in the sample. We have our sample now, which we label with a sample ID that was given. And we have a pretty fun platform now, actually that's on your phone, which allows us to input all kinds of sample descriptions for this. And so we have, you can input a photo of where you got the sample, you can input the latitude and longitude, time, date, and then what kind of detergent you use. And all this stuff gives us the ability to look back later and say, this is where this sample was if we find any positives. Once you have your sample, we put it in the freezer where we know it's going to preserve better and a little bit longer. And then we make sure to dispose of our gloves and of all of the different things that could have touched triazole in an appropriate waste bag, which we also have in here. And then added to that, we also have fun tubes of homemade hand sanitizer. And so that's kind of generally how the sampling process works. Ultimately, then we take all of these different samples and we pass them on to the other awesome people in our lab who are doing the actual detection of it using real-time reverse transcriptase PCR.
That is so fascinating. And I want to make sure everyone knows I'm going to have the links to the article and to Jason's Instagram and also the sampling kits, and that information will all be in the description box below. That leads me to a more personal question that folks wanted to know, sort of a real life application of what you're doing. What do you do when you go home with groceries from the supermarket?
Well, that's a really great question. And one thing that is important to keep in mind is that there's a lot that we don't know about COVID-19. And one of those things that we don't understand very well is the asymptomatic reservoir or the asymptomatic population of people that aren't displaying symptoms, but that are infected with COVID-19 and can actively shed the virus. And so there's been this big debate in the news recently about masks. And this is ongoing. One of the first things that's really, really important to note is that surgical masks and N95s, since we are still in short supply in this country, need to go to the healthcare professionals to make sure that they can be better protected, right? But there's also this debate of whether or not masks would help reduce the spread in the population. And the answer is probably yes. While we're not sure everything about this yet, and there's an ongoing debate in the scientific community right now whether or not the virus can be spread through aerosols. So whether or not it's staying in the air for extended periods of time, and it may be. And in that case, it's really, really important to protect ourselves. And while masks they're not 100% guarantee that they'll keep us from getting sick, they can reduce the spread of things like viral droplets. And so they can both keep infected people from infecting others and keep people who are uninfected from getting infected. On the topic of groceries, we don't have a ton of information on whether or not groceries can, or whether or not we're seeing this virus on things like groceries. Hopefully our sampling project will help give us a little bit of information on things like that. But for the moment, if it makes you more comfortable to sterilize those things, I think that's a great idea.
Okay, finally, I think this is a question that's on everyone's mind, and we would love to know your opinion. Do you think that life will ever return to normal after this?
That's the question that everybody wants to know, honestly. I want to know that answer. And unfortunately, we don't have all the answers. Even our best models and our best predictions can't tell us exactly what the next months are going to look like and what it's going to look like after. Imperial College London came out with a really wonderful study that makes a pretty accurate prediction for what the next couple months could look like, in which, until we get a vaccine, we could be seeing these relaxing of restrictions at some point. And then as soon as we have to really, really tightly monitor ICU beds and the cases in hospitals, and as soon as those start to increase, so we can see that infections are going up, we have to, they do something called suppression, where you tighten restrictions again, institute quarantine and social distancing again. And it kind of goes up and down in waves like that. And that's kind of, I think, what the general consensus is coming to, is that's what it's going to look like. So one of the positives I think we can glean from this whole crisis, and especially over the next few months is that this new normal really, really is making us more adaptive and offering up opportunities in the future for us to be able to do our work from home, for us to be able to maybe for people to take longer maternity or paternity leaves, to be able to take care of their kids and to really, really develop this more conscious awareness of hygiene, right? And so one thing I mentioned is in the article is that when was the last time you heard people actually washing their hands for 20 seconds? Or when was the last time that you heard somebody say, oh, if you're sick, you should stay home, right? These are really, really foundational things that make sense from a disease standpoint, but that we're being forced to reevaluate now as a culture. And I think that that's going to be, I hesitate to say we're going to move back to a new normal, because I think that experiences like this ultimately do make us stronger, and they ultimately do teach our culture how to handle this better. And so I look forward to seeing what's going to happen. Although, hopefully we can continue to institute these policies and stay on top of it so that we can reduce the impacts and the negative impacts that this has on people.
Yeah, I think that's well said. And I think that this process is going to be painful. It is really difficult to give people the green light, and everyone gets so excited and they run out and they start socializing, and then things start to spike again, and it's going to be very difficult to tell people, okay, we got to go back. But that's going to be essential until we get a vaccine.
Absolutely. And I think one really important foundation of that is collaboration as a society. And so one thing that we can take away from all this is that this does end faster if we cooperate, and the more that we can accept this kind of social and moral responsibility to adhering to these guidelines and to being aware of both, the people and the threats, the microbiological threats around us, right? And then also being aware of our potential to spread them, I think is a really important thing to keep in mind here. And so kind of emphasizing that social responsibility and, making sure that we all do our part in, because it really is a global effort at this point, That's the funny thing about pandemics is they kind of involve everybody.
They unite us by definition, yes, whether we want them to or not, that's for sure. Closing, I just have one question, which is, what is it like for you to be a part of this huge story right now?
We are one piece of the puzzle, you know what I mean? And so every scientist, every lab that's working on this is contributing in some way to trying to help us understand what we're facing. It's a really incredible time in science when a lot of people can come together and try to apply themselves and apply their intelligence and their capacity to this large scale goal. So it's a really, really cool puzzle to be a part of. I do emphasize once again that we are but a small part. And I have, we are standing on the shoulders of giants. So,
well, I have to say on behalf of everyone watching, thank you for everything that you are doing, and stay safe, stay healthy. And thank you so much for taking the time to talk with me today.
Absolutely. It was a pleasure. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you so much for watching the Penguin Prof channel. Links to everything that we talked about will be in the description bar below. Everyone stay safe, stay home, take care. Bye-bye.